So we have to gather that evidence. We're doing a lot of kind of that hard evidence. I know there's things like the Equality and Human Rights Commission. They've just launched their interim report on the cumulative impact of welfare reform, and that's absolutely clear in black and white. Disabled people are being disproportionately impacted, and the higher your support needs, the higher the loss of income. And we have the UN. So there's a lot of that hard research, but in campaigning, it's also very much about gathering our own experiences and stories, and at a local level, using that in the media and with the decision makers. Particularly the media, they love a personal story. We just need to make sure that we link it up with the analysis and be really clear about what we want. Because I think a lot of media are stuck now. They've been on a journey, and at the beginning of the ILF, they want, you know, the first actions with the ILF, they wanted to go and speak to the non-disabled CEO of Scope. And I think they started to realise that they need to come and speak to us and ILF users. But they're still stuck at, oh, we want the personal experience from the disabled, and then we'll go somewhere else for the, you know, the policy analysis, and we need to be able to do all of it. Are you fine?
Yeah. I think one of the things I found for our campaign is that we're campaigning for independent living, and we're trying to make the distinction between independent living is not the same as getting out of bed in the morning or having your arse wiped. You know, and it's hard to do that because some people are even struggling to get that basic support.
Yeah.
And that, I think that's one of the difficulties for our campaign, is getting that message over, is what is increasingly being offered by local authorities, so-called clean and feed routines, which are, in some local authorities, been limited to 15 minutes. That's increasingly looking like what the future is being offered to disabled people.
Yeah.
And that's not independent living, and that's barely surviving.
Yeah.
And I suppose it's how we communicate that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, it's the same thing with the housing activists saying that, oh, affordable housing. Then they say, oh, it's £500,000. So you're saying, okay, so how can you define, okay, £500,000 for a flat is affordable to some people, most people, nobody I know.
Yeah.
But they just change the... They've just changed the language all the time.
Yeah. I think that's a real challenge about how we kind of communicate what we mean by independent living. And also in a way that doesn't fall into other traps that is increasingly happening, like describing disabled people as automatically vulnerable. You know, there's a lot of other stuff coming in that we need to challenge. There is obviously, I'll just finish this bit off, so obviously there's the other key kind of part of campaigning is using the opportunities for kind of formal submission of views and ideas through taking part in consultations. Now, it is shocking to find out that the Green Paper on social care is excluding working age disabled people.
Yeah.
We've got to challenge that. Well, it's that lobbying, Mark. It's probably taking part in that consultation and saying how, totally short-term and inappropriate it is to not include working-age disabled people. I think we've got to use all of these tools. And I just wanted to... Kevin Caulfield from Hammersmith and Fulham Coalition Against Cuts was going to come and talk about the amazing work that HAFCAC have done in Hammersmith and Fulham, because it's a great example of how a really small group of disabled people, I think he likes to say, like, you know, four Crips and a dog, have absolutely changed everything in Hammersmith and Fulham. So I'm going to attempt to just very briefly kind of say what they did, and there is a lot we can learn from what's happening in Hammersmith and Fulham, the change they've made, but also now there is such really interesting co-production going on between the local authority and disabled people that it's a real example that we need to know about and lobby for. So basically, Hammersmith and Fulham, under the previous Conservative local government wanted to institute charging. Hammersmith and Fulham Coalition Against Cuts was formed, a really small group of disabled people, to challenge that, and they used the legal route. They took the council to court and basically challenged their right to charge for home care on the grounds that it was discriminatory and the Quality Act and the Public Sector Duty. Now, they lost that legal challenge, but that was a two-year delay. They managed to delay the implementation of that charging policy by 2 years, which firstly saved local disabled people in Hammersmith and Fulham a lot of money. But what very importantly it did was raise the profile of charging, but also of disabled people in that borough. So they also gathered lots of evidence, they had a huge petition, and I think they, if not direct action, they were definitely maximising the local democratic opportunities to kind of watch debates, contribute, show the petitions to the politicians. Very importantly, they built up a really close relationship with the opposition party, the Labour Party at the time. And the Labour Party signed up to abolishing home care charging, which was quite a coup. And then they also did lots of work around Operation Disabled Vote to get disabled people in Hammersmith and Fulham out and voting. Now, they weren't recommending which party to vote for, because that's probably, you know, would definitely, you know, be against the rules if they were a registered charity. They're not, they're just a group of activists, which gave them a lot more independence than the local DDPO. But they were just out and about raising awareness, and also raising awareness of the different parties' manifesto commitments to disabled people. And frankly, the evidence spoke for itself, really. And lo and behold, the Labour group won, the Labour Party got in Hammersmith and Fulham, and they went on to abolish home care charging in that borough. And I think at the moment, it's currently the only borough that is not charging. So, but that's just the start of it. They also committed to ring fencing independent living funding. And they then initiated a Disabled People's Commission. And that commission has just come up with a whole set of strategic recommendations for changing the way services are designed and run and delivered, with disabled people being at the heart of that. So there's really exciting work going on there. And that is a result of a small group of activists. So it is being done as we speak, guys. And I think Kevin and Hafkak are going to be doing a lot more sharing of the kind of tools that they learned through this process. And Kevin, kind of, one of the things he says, which I really like, is a few tips from Hafkak is: be fearless, we only live once. But make sure you have a really independent campaign group that can be fearless in relation to those in power. So I think, as been mentioned before, DPOs now are often silenced. And if a DPO has funding from a local authority, they can often be threatened with the withdrawal of that funding if they speak up and challenge. A local campaign group that's kind of arm's length to a DPO can't be threatened like that, because they haven't got any money and they're entirely independent. So that's a model that we know works, and we're trying to support DPOs to kind of work with other local activists to kind of set up that combination. Build relationships with local politicians where you can. You never know what might happen, i.e. you know, a victory. Remind politicians often that we are local residents, generally here to stay, and voters, and that is really key. You know, politicians don't really, you know, I can write as a CEO of an organisation, it doesn't really cut much ice, but in election time, you write as voters, and they're interested. make connections with good lawyers if you can, and I think that's a, that's back to using the law. And I mean, we run a DDPO legal network in London where we bring DPOs together with lawyers. We need that replicated across the country, so we probably need to be doing some lobbying of the Equality and Human Rights Committee to get that funding up. Stick to your aims and messages, which is what we're just about to get on to. Even if it seems unlikely, you will achieve them. We were told by a council leader in a council meeting, you need to start living it in the real world. There will never be no charging. Well, you know, if they had accepted that, we wouldn't be where we are. So, you know, it's back to be fearless. We need a vision. We need to be really clear about what we demand, and laugh occasionally. So, in terms of, well, what do we do about trying to effectively campaign to secure that right to independent living? Some of the questions that I thought we could just maybe kick off a discussion with are, include things like, you know, are we clear about what independent living means, and are we communicating this? Increasingly, as Brian said, there's this really kind of functional idea that it's about helping people with particular tasks or functions. The Independent Living Fund is over, and that was the very example that we could point to and go, this is what we mean by independent living, you know, holistic support that, that you are to a greater extent in control of. What are the arguments for independent living? You know, that classic test, if we were in the lift with a decision maker, have we got 5 points that we could just bang to somebody that would convince somebody that, oh God, but yeah, that makes sense. And do we have a clear set of goals about how we go about achieving that? So they're just a few of my questions that I think probably be useful to help us get some objectives and actions. But they might be wrong, and you might have a whole set of other questions to put. So yeah, how do we get to that point? Using some of the tools that I've just talked about, you know, whether it's lobbying, media, legal action, solidarity, local elections, what do we need to do over the next year?
I think one of the biggest things is reaching all the said people who aren't involved yet and don't know that they have a voice and can use it. It's how do we find them? In Hounslow, for example, from the my MP writing to the council, she learned that there's over 40 people who were who are exile users, but Mitchell Wolf was supporting me, supporting the other person that I found. So only two of us. He's willing to support the others, but how do I find them? If we could, it's not just about lobbying the government and the councils. It's about lobbying disabled people themselves and their carers and their families to all get behind this.
Yeah.
You know, as long as it's just a minority of us speaking, they can ignore us and say the majority and acceptance of this or support this.
Yeah.
By default, our silence is counted as support. So one of the biggest things, I think, is actually finding ways of getting everyone to join us.
And we could maybe come back and discuss some of the actions that we could do to do that. Mm-hmm. Do you want to come in?
I wanted to say that I agree with what the lady said, but I also think that a lot of the grassroots community, they don't know their rights. They don't have the confidence. They don't have the knowledge. They don't have the willpower because they've been crushed and crushed and crushed. So we've got to work with them to get them to have that voice back within their own local communities, to help them and nurture them and educate them on their rights, so that they do then help us join in our struggle for independent living. And maybe it's some of the terminology, because sometimes even our own community get lost within this terminology that we use, whether it's independent living, what do you mean by that? You know, and especially if you've got English as a second language, and if you've got communication needs, you're really lost, because what do you mean? You know, and if you're not communicating, you know, how do you reach out to that group of people? People with learning disabilities, how do we reach out? And, you know, they're the most vulnerable. I don't like saying that, but they are, because I went to a Power ICAS meeting and they said only about 3% people with learning disability have the same marriages or whatever, more than a 70% mainstream community. Now, that's a really low number.
Yeah.
I'm ashamed, and it's same, I'm ashamed of the Labour Party saying they're good allies to us, and they've only got 4% of disabled people in the Labour Party. So where's our representation?
Yeah.
So we need to lobby for change there and say, well, if you really mean that you're there for us, where's our disabled activists who are your Labour members? Why aren't you supporting them to be councillors or whatever? And why isn't our percentage the same number?
Someone out of bed in the morning and putting them back to bed at night and giving them one main meal in the day and leaving them in that piece for the rest of the time is independent living. That is not independent living. That's not even living.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we have to take that back from them.
Yeah. So we've got to look at how we communicate our view and then
what life is.
Yeah.
Disabilities, hidden or not, and they've seen how perverse the system has become, working from the inside. So perhaps there's some potential there.
Yeah. I think that's absolutely key, to build alliances and allies. And I know there are a number of like social work networks that DPAC are working with. With social workers that are really not happy with what's going on. So absolutely.
Sorry, Mark. There's just a couple of other people that. Did you want to come in and then?
Yeah, I just wanted to come back on what you were saying about the Labour Party. One of the problems that Labour Party members have faced recently is that Disability Labour, which is the main affiliated social society for people with disabilities, has not been proactive in challenging the Labour Party, which is why I and a whole group of other people have got together, and we've now got an organisation called DEAL, which is Disability Equality Act Labour, which is about making the Labour Party Equalities Act compliant. We've got a document, we've got a website, there's leaflets out there on the front if people want to take them and have a look and get involved. So there are ways of doing that. Believe you me, we are not sitting down quietly to do this.
So just on that, it's a really interesting point, because the Equality Act doesn't really cover independent living. So is there something about all of the networks that we run, set up, that we need to all agree to have Article 19 and the right to independent living as one of our key asks?
Yeah.
So whether we're involved in trade unions or it's kind of consultations with the mayor, or that we all sign up to securing this right.
I would make, I have just been assessed, God knows what it was, but by a social worker quite recently who was disabled, but actually could not understand why I can safely drive a car, but why I cannot pick up and carry a hot cup of tea or coffee without dropping it and breaking it and scalding myself. So sometimes even having a disabled social worker doesn't enable them to understand what the issues are that you're facing every day.
Made aware of independent living, what it means, and then their advice to pass it on at the ground level across the country. And also I just add that there needs to be something in terms of the social security system. It's not accepted by estate agencies, housing associations, landlords any longer. It's not seen as real money. The universal credits created a bigger problem there as well. I know in employment you've got positive about disability. Maybe there could be something like a disability positive for estate agencies they could voluntarily sign up to. They want to make adjustments to people's homes and so forth. A voluntary policy like that. Some employers have signed up to something similar for the poverty area.
Yeah, there's loads of problems with kind of those kind of schemes. I mean, the kind of disability confident thing for employers. I would say it's not meaningful in any way, and actually what it is, it gives cover to the government to say there is something being done, but that it's all self-assessment, there's no actions that need to be done, there's no, I mean it's just, it's window shopping, I would say. I'm just conscious we're kind of starting to move. What time is it now? We've only got just over 5 minutes left, so just kind of pulling up. Everybody's here, so most people are linked up in some way already, so I think this is the kind of core group, but I guess it's like one of the things we need to do is what can we do to spread the word. But I mean, just kind of reflecting back on the discussion up to now, so we've got something about
honing our definition and description of independent living, and then kind of developing a communication strategy so we get that out, whether that's to other disabled people, to the media, to local decision makers. There's then something about us all signing up to that, so that, you know, if we can turn around and go, there's 100,000 people have signed up to this definition of independent living, that's quite compelling. There is the building alliances, whether it's social workers, other advice agencies, other human rights organisations. That's absolutely critical. Doing the lobbying with politicians, but linked to that, mentioning the total invisibility of us in kind of public life and the need to do work to increase our representation. Any other key things? Do you think we need to kind of get the parties, political parties, to A, keep signing up to independent living, but then to co-produce co-produce the policies with us?
Yeah. I know that when the Labour Party manifesto was being written, they did actually come out and speak to quite a number of disabled people, including myself, about what went into the manifesto. And certainly the mini-manifesto on disabled people, which was had the standard tag, nothing about us without us, was very much written in consultation with varying disabled groups in the UK, particularly DPAC.
So I think, you know, John MacDonald has come out very recently to talk about he will share power with disabled people. So that's got to happen now, I think, as Mark said, not once they're in.
Yeah, I would agree, and we'll be in that direction.
And I just mentioned one more point. We'll get the young disabled people, because they are our future disabled people. We need to be empowering them, meeting their needs, not crumbling them, because at the moment, at grassroots level, where the cuts in services, a lot of the young disabled people are not getting their needs met, either from university, education, whatever, inclusive education, whatever, and then they're not being empowered, they're being crushed. So if we don't empower them, they're not going to have the next generation of us. So we need to be empowering them and nurturing them and being role models for them and maybe mentoring and supporting them so that they are empowered to take our struggles forward.
Are you going to write up
of what you think about today?
Well, I mean, I think we're going to feedback on some of the workshops, and then I think the last session is looking at the key campaign actions and objectives we want. So hopefully feed this in. I mean, I just think, guys, on a really positive note, and it echoes that the film that we started today with, there's a huge mobilisation of disabled people. By no means, we're still a tiny minority, but compared to where we were 8 years ago, I mean, it's Brian's point, when the ILS started to be restricted, there was nobody challenging that. So we've done a huge amount of work. You look at the UN and the profile that the UN Disability Committee's concluding observations have, by no means as much as it should be, but it did get media attention. So, you know, we've done an amazing amount as a movement, and it's us finding the energy to keep going and keeping engaging with lots of new people.
We're getting some a kind of central call of PR support for all disabled people around the country who want to campaign on this, that they can draw on. So if there's a DPO, maybe in Newcastle or Manchester, well, I know actually Brian does a pretty good job on that in Manchester, but maybe some other areas that don't have that kind of resource, that they could draw on. You could get some funding, and then they could also collect all these independent living stories as well. Yeah. So whether the media will know then, the mainstream media will know then, if there's a story about independent living, well, we can go to there, and they might be able to get us a story from... I don't know whether that's realistic.
Yeah. So I was actually wondering as well, is there a way, as you said, that it's been mentioned that a lot of disabled people don't even know about their rights. Is there, a workshop where they can go and actually find out?
Well, I I mean, there's no simple answer. DPOs, which are really struggling, should be given the capacity and resources to go into local care homes and institutions and start doing that work. I mean, I think if we're wanting to develop a communication strategy, it then begs the question, how do we then implement that strategy? So I think that's a good idea. I know, like, the frequently asked questions guide that came out of the Save the ILF Fund has been shared quite a lot. So I think the network here is a kind of one hub to kind of share stuff. But that's a good idea, John, yeah. Any other kind of final action, campaign actions or points that you want us to feedback?
Just the lady, it's just a thought for you. It's very constructive. It's just that the lady was talking about empowering people. My experience as a disabled carer, much more disabled person, suffering me, is that the people we employ as assistants to my son are having the most appalling difficulties. We've got such able people, such gifted people working for us, who should be earning far, far more. I don't know, almost as if the issue you brought up is almost submerged in the difficulties that the whole of the young population is having.
They're crushed. Our young disabled people at the moment are being crushed.
I'm sure, yeah, they're more crushed. But also more young people that we employ are also being crushed. We've had such clever people working for us that I just can't believe that somebody has, that some employer hasn't grabbed them. They're so able, some of them.
Norman Lamb was at the North East Day just on Wednesday, and I wanted to ask him about how he feels about the implementation of the Care Act, but I didn't have the guts to go up and ask him. But perhaps he would want to get involved in, because he was one of the architects, and perhaps it'd be good to have him give view. He's a carer as well. So
he's becoming much more passionate again now he's not in power. I mean, we met with him and he argued that there wasn't a need to have an independent living principle, that the wellbeing principle would cover it. But we ended up getting it in the statutory guidance. Obviously, he was also very clear about reducing the number of people with learning difficulties in assessment treatment units. The number's gone up. So, but yeah, I think he's a useful and high profile spokesperson now for challenging the current state. And I know there's a group of, I think, 30 or 50 MPs that have called for cross-party.
90.
Is it 90? Right, okay. So maybe we need to be contacting them as well, because if they're calling for cross-party conversations about social care, we need to be influencing them as well.
I interviewed them about a year ago at the Lib Dem conference, and I said, well, what about the thought of calling it a National Independent Living Service rather than a National Care Service? And he seemed to think that was a good idea, but... So he might be open to some of the ideas that's on him.
Yeah. And also perhaps the answer is to bring social care and health together.
We want to bring the free at the point of need bit across, but I think, yeah, there's huge concerns that we have, and we need to be communicating those as well, because I think there's a lot of politicians who just rush to merge it without knowing the details. Okay, I think that's the, I think we've run out of time, folks, so thank you. I think that's tea and coffee.
Okay, thank you guys, back soon. It's going to be the,
You did nothing with it after, you know, that year.